angels sing, Jesus, the light of the world. Glory to the newborn King, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, we'll walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shined all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Christ by highest heaven adore, Jesus, the light of the world. Christ, the everlasting Lord, Jesus, the light of the world. Everyone sing the chorus. Oh, we'll walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shined all around us by day and by night. Hi, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, we'll walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shined all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Jesus, the light of the world. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Of righteousness, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, we'll walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shined all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, we'll walk, everyone standing on this song, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shined all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Let's sing it one more time. Oh, we'll walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shined all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Remain standing, praise the Lord.
I don't know the speaking of the hour personally, neither do I know his sermon title, so we might be praying for understanding. Well, the Lord will be for this evening. I have chosen to paraphrase Jeremiah prayers in Jeremiah 32. Difficulties around Jerusalem and the king court, and even the prophet himself was in deep trouble. He could not even deliver himself, neither the city of God, and on this particular hour, he prayed. So let's bow our head. And he says, O Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you. Lord, there's nothing too hard for you. You have showed your loving kindness so many times, not only to one, but to many of us. Lord, you have not repaid our iniquities, and as we should. Lord, you are a great and mighty God, whose name is the Lord of hosts. You are, in the midst of confusion, you are great in counsel and mighty at work, for your eyes are open to all the ways of the sons of men. Lord, we thank you because you have given us this church, this denomination, you have given us a ministry. Lord, you have brought us so far, Father, and we bless you because you have given us a church, bless us with doctrines and belief that is like the land that flow milk and honey. Father, you have given us possession of this precious church, and we ask that you help us to obey your voice and to walk in your law. Lord, that there may be nothing that you command that we will do. Father, thank you for the privilege of praying with Jeremiah for understanding in the midst of great difficulty and confusion. In the name of Jesus, give us the understanding to heed the word of the preacher of this hour. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
This 27th special Congress, where God has been blessing all day long, we're blessed tonight after having so much good spiritual food, food that has been blessings to each one of us, tonight to have some dessert. How many of y'all like dessert? And you know, in order to have your dessert, you have to eat your vegetables. But we've had some good food already, but now it's time to have some dessert. Our speaker tonight is none other than Pastor Andrea King. She's coming to us with a word from the Lord. She's a graduate from Oakwood College in 1999 and also a graduate of Andrews University. She is the wife of one husband. His name is Kirk King. Pastor King, would you stand? Where are you? There he is. They also have two wonderful children, Lauren and Jonathan. She is the co-pastor of the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church, and before that, she was a pastor of the 31st Street Church, both in San Diego, California. It's good to have you here, Pastor King, and I know the Lord has a word to deliver to you tonight. Before she comes to bless us with a word from God, we're going to hear from anointed songstress, Sister Kathy Thompson.
Number 5, please. Can you hear me? Number 5, please. Thank you. Talk to you. to clear your mind and let the Lord talk to you. Don't move so fast, seeking what won't last, and let the Lord talk.
I'd like to thank Sister Thomas for that beautiful selection. Amen? Amen? Is that not our prayer this evening, that the Lord would talk to us? Let him speak to our hearts in the name of Jesus. It is indeed a privilege to be here. I praise God for each and every one of you. We are co-laborers in Christ. Amen? Amen. And though we're in different parts of the vineyard, God's Holy Spirit joins us together as family. I'd like to thank the committee for allowing me this opportunity. And I just praise God for each and every one of you. I know that there are some female pastors and chaplains and theology majors that perhaps are in the audience. And just a little plug, we're going to be getting together tomorrow for lunch. Female pastors and chaplains, theology majors, we're going to, around 1 o'clock, we're going to meet in the Mosey Complex at Pastor Kwesi's office. Had to put that little plug in. That being said, it is good to see my president, the president and ministerial director of the Great Southeastern California Conference. We praise God for him. And I praise God for my husband, and I see my mother and family have joined us. And once again, we praise God for his word. Turn in your Bibles with us to Matthew chapter 8. I'll read in your hearing verses 8 through 13. Matthew chapter 8, starting with verse 8, and I'll read through verse 13. And I'll be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. It says, the centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from the east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way. As you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed at that same hour. I solicit your prayers this evening as I speak to you with a message, only speak a word. Only speak a word. Shall we pray? Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, you are already in this place. And God, we welcome you. We would hear a word from you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your spirit would be with us and allow us to experience something supernatural. You said in your word, who may ascend to the holy mountain of the Lord? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, cleanse us, O God, as we enter into your presence. And we promise when all is said and done that we will not hesitate to give you the praise, the honor and the glory, for truly you are worthy, and worthy is the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen, amen and amen. Jesus had just come down from the mountaintop where he delivered his famous Sermon on the Mount. Throngs of people followed him, and he entered into the city of Capernaum. And it was there that he met with the elders of the Jews. They had something very special to ask of Jesus. They needed him to do something for them. There was a Roman soldier, a centurion, and he needed Jesus' assistance. Now, the elders didn't really like Jesus, but this centurion was powerful, and he had done so many good things for the Jews that they decided they would swallow their pride because they wanted to stay on this Roman's good side. And so they begged Jesus to go with them and to heal this centurion's servant. They wanted Jesus to know that this man was not a waste of his time. This man, they said, he was worthy. He was the kind of guy you wanted to owe you one. They began to spout off his resume. He loves our nation, and he built us a synagogue. He gives money to the church, and he fights for religious liberty. He's always down for the cause. All right. They told Jesus that he had to do this because this man was worthy of his blessing. Jesus agreed to go with them, and the Bible says that he wasn't far from the centurion's house when the centurion came out to meet Jesus. He said, I don't know what they told you, but I want you to know that I am not worthy. Not worthy for you to come into my house. I'm not worthy to be having this conversation with you. Now we see a little discrepancy. Because the elders had already declared that he was indeed worthy. They looked at what he had done and how much he gave, and they declared that he was worthy. They thought that the things that you do gives you a special standing with God. They forgot that the only thing that qualifies us for a blessing from God is our need. There is nothing that can commend us to God save the merits of Jesus Christ. So we can't be confused. We're not worthy of anything, no matter what we've paid, no matter what we've done, no matter what we've given. So the centurion, with all of his power and money, with all the church folk liking him, he knew that he was unworthy. And so he made Jesus a proposition. He said, look, I'm a man under authority, and I have people under me. And I know that you know how it works. I can tell one to go and he goes. And I can tell another to come and he comes. I can tell my servant to do it and it gets done. And now if I, unworthy as I am, can do all of that, then I know that all you have to do is just speak a word. See, I know that if you tell disease to go, it'll go. I know that if you call the angels that excel in strength and tell them to come, they will come. If you say be healed, it is done. Only speak a word. See, this man understood leadership, authority, and submission. He had all of this power, and he told people to do things, and they did them. But he also said he was a man under authority. That meant he knew how to take orders. That meant when they told him to come, he came. That meant when they told him to do, he did. And even though he had lots of people under him, he still understood that he had to submit to those who were over him. Leadership one-on-one. I'm about to help a lot of us in our churches. If we're going to be leaders, if we want people to follow us, we've got to learn to follow. Amen, somebody. This was a man who was versed in submission and discipline. And even though by the very nature of his position, he could have commanded Jesus come, but instead he submitted himself and his problem to Christ's word. The question that puzzles me, though, is how could this centurion know the power that was couched in Christ's words? How could this pagan know that by the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and the host of them by the word of his mouth? How did he know that by just a word, a wind stopped their chatting and waves stopped their churning? How did he know that by his word, death would flee and the blind would see? How could he know? How could he know that sicknesses would be healed and furnaces were chilled by his word? How did he know that all Jesus had to do was speak a word and everything would be made right? How did this pagan know? Flesh and blood did not reveal this to him. For the Bible says that spiritual things are spiritually discerned. This was a man with faith. Not just any old kind of faith, but this was deep faith. This was a man who had so much faith, he made Jesus marvel. The Bible says only twice that Jesus marveled. I want you to understand the gravity of this situation, because this is, the God of the universe. Yeah. That means he's seen everything. He made everything. And so it has to be something special that makes this God take a second look. But the Bible says that he marveled at the faith of this man. The other time he marveled was at the unbelief of Israel. Jesus said, I haven't found this much faith even in Israel. Now, don't get it twisted. There was faith in Israel. There were many who were healed and many who saw the power of God. Jesus oftentimes prefaced his miracles with, be it unto you according to your faith. So there was faith in Israel. The dead was raised and demons were cast out. The lame did walk and the blind, their eyes were opened. But Jesus saw something different in this centurion. He had a different level of faith. See, the people of Israel, they were always looking for a sign. They wanted proof. Don't just tell me, I've got to see it with my own eyes. Oh, yes, they received every miracle and they sucked up every blessing, but they still rejected the Savior. They had faith for a little while, you know, as long as they could see him. But, oh, if Jesus were to go around the corner, if they stopped looking at him and they couldn't see what he was doing, then their faith went out the window. The centurion, on the other hand, didn't have to see Jesus' face. He didn't have to see a sign. Oh, Jesus, I don't need you to stop by. See, I know that when you came down to earth, you belittled yourself. You wrapped yourself in humanity for our benefit. I don't need your flesh and blood to come by because I know that the power is not in your flesh. It's in your words. Only speak a word. The centurion just wanted the word of God because he knew that it contained all the power he needed for healing and renewal and deliverance. Only speak a word. Yeah. This is faith on a new level. This is believing God's words when there's no physical evidence that God is going to come through. This is believing God's word when everything you see and hear seems contrary to what he has said. This is standing on the word of God and allowing its power to take root in you and transform your life despite any bad report or negative circumstances. This is the type of faith that we need in the last days. Jesus, in his parable about the persistent widow, talked about how she would go to the unjust judge and continue to plead her case. And finally, he gave in, not because of anything righteousness on his part, but just because he was tired of hearing her talk. And Jesus said, the moral of the story is this. If he'll do that for her and he's an unjust judge, imagine what I'll do for you and I am a just judge. I am the giver of every good and perfect gift. But then Jesus tacks something onto it. He says, but when the Son of Man comes, will he find any faith on the earth? Jesus sounds a little concerned. Maybe he looked down and saw our faces and wondered, would he find any faith on the earth? Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he who comes to him must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. He's looking for faith. See, we are living in the last days of Earth's history. You all do believe that, don't you? The Bible says in Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people shall be delivered. Everyone who is found written in the book. We are to be preparing for the final crisis when all we will have is the word of God. And we've got to stand on that word. We've got to know that word. We've got to trust in that word during the times of peace and prosperity. lest our faith fail during times of trials and tribulations. Now is the time to taste and see that God is good. Now is the time to understand that he who promised is faithful, not just some of the time, but all of the time. There is no shadow of turning with him. We've got to believe in the word of God and the power thereof, not just the parts that say you're going to hell if you do this and that, but you've got to believe the parts that say you can have power. You've got to believe the parts that say that God is going to do something magnificent. In these last days, God is looking for a strong church. He's looking for a powerful church. He's ready to pour out the latter rain upon us so that he can be glorified and he can wrap this thing up. But he's having trouble finding people who have enough faith to contain this thing. Enough faith to live the word of God. Now, I know you think I'm preaching to the person sitting next to you because you believe the word of God. And so did the Jews. They could quote you scripture up and down. They could tell you about the law and the judgment, the impending judgment of God. But it took a heathen, a pagan, to believe that God's word wasn't just for the scrolls, that God's word wasn't just to be read in church, but that it still had creative power. For thousands of years, people have been assembling on the seventh day of the week, in honor of creation, celebrating the creative power of God. Every week we come as commanded to commemorate the time that God stepped out on nothing and said, let there be, and there was. We get excited about how powerful God's words were. But I stop by to tell you that they have not lost a single ounce of their power. He still speaks and it is. He still commands and it stands fast. And Hebrews 1:3 says that he upholds all things by the word of his power. Now notice, it didn't say by the power of his word. It said the word of his power. That means that God expresses his power through his word. That's why God looked down on the mess of man. And though there were a myriad of things that God could have sent down to him to heal him and to help him, but God decided to send his word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And that Word, it contained all that we needed for salvation, life, and godliness. That word had healing power and saving power and forgiving power and resurrection power. See, the words of God are containers. They contain God's power. God said, let there be light, and his words carried all the elements needed to make light. His word sent light, propelled it at 186,000 miles per second. And after all these years, light has not slowed down yet. And scientists will concur that the universe continues to expand at the speed of light. Why? Because God said it. He said, let there be light. And his words have not lost an ounce of their power. It was Christ who said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. Said my covenant, I will not break nor alter the word that comes from my mouth. For as the rain comes down and snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. And it shall prosper in the thing for which it was sent. This centurion understood the timeless principle that if God sends his word, it cannot fail. That's why his only request was only speak a word. When Jesus walked the earth, he spoke to people and their problems were solved. He spoke to the leper. He spoke to the centurion's servant and they were healed. He spoke to Lazarus and he was raised from the dead. He spoke to the winds and the waves and they were stilled. He spoke to demons and they fled. Some of you are saying to yourself, if only I had been there. If only Jesus could have spoken to me. If only he could have spoken to my child or my situation, then perhaps my life would be different. I want you to know that Jesus has spoken to your life. He has spoken to your situation. That's why he gave you his word, to reveal himself to you, his word to you. Most assuredly, I say unto you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father. God has reserved a greater portion of his power for his last day church. That should have made somebody get excited. Perhaps the reason that we're not excited, somebody might be saying it in their mind, if God's got all this power, then why am I dying of cancer? If God's got all this power, then why is there such havoc in my home and in my church? If God's got all this power, why am I a slave to addiction, strung out on pornography, can't get my eating right? Why can't I get from under this thing? Isaiah 5:13 says, therefore my people have gone into captivity because they have no knowledge. Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. God's people need knowledge of the word. And what has happened as of late, God's people have been trying to get by hearing this sermon and that sermon, going to this conference and that conference, and do not have a knowledge of the word. They only know a couple of verses so they could prove to their family that they are right when they go to church on Saturday. We don't know what the word says we can have, and so we don't have it. We don't know what the word says we can do, and so we don't do it. As the people of God, we have got to get in the word of God, the pure, unadulterated, unwatered down word of God. Some of us need to not buy another sermon tape until we buy the Bible on tape and let the word of God get down in our spirits and change us. Oh, I want to read the word. I want to listen to it when I'm driving in my car. I want it all around me because I want to get to the point that I believe the word of God more than I believe what the doctors say. I want to believe the word of God more than what experts are talking about it and what tests are showing and what research shows and what studies show. We have got to cling to the word of God and have faith in it. What is faith? Romans 4:21, being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. For all the promises of God are yea in him and amen. 2 Peter 1, verses 3 and 4 says, as his divine power has given to us all things, somebody say all things, pertaining to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who has called us by glory and virtue, by which we have been given exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped corruption that is in the world through lust. God's power has given to us all things pertaining to life and godliness through his great and exceedingly great and precious promises. That's why we've got to believe in his word. That is God's mode of operation. That's the way things were created, by a word. And that's how things will come into your life, by his word. Has he said it, and shall he not do it? Has he not spoken, and shall he not make it good? That's why the centurion said, only speak a word. If you just give me your word, then I know that it'll be worked out. The good news is that God's word is not just for that centurion, but God has spoken a word to you. Your life, your ministry does not have to continue like it is. Your marriage doesn't have to be like it is if it is not according to the word of God. For the Bible says that what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. And I think I would be safe to say no man, no woman, no secretary, no a church, no children, no job. Let nothing put it asunder. Oh, I can't hear nobody pray now. Sleeping on separate ends of the house. I'm so glad God has spoke to you this day and said, but now in Jesus Christ, you who were once afar off are now made near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace and has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation. I'm so glad he spoke a word. Mental illness does not have to run rampant in your life. Why? Because God has not given us the spirit of fear, but he's given us love, power, and a sound mind. For he will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Only speak a word. Some of you are wondering how you're going to get through this Christmas season, since the bills are high and the money is low. But my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory. I have been young and soon I'll be old, but yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Only speak a word. Body racked with disease, that shall not be your portion in Jesus' name. For the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. The prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if there be any sins, they shall be forgiven him. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from all their destruction. The Bible says that everything you need for life and godliness are in the word of God. Now, while everybody is shouting about how God is going to provide for life, somebody shout godliness. Don't get so caught up with praying and claiming things concerning life that you forget godliness. Because more than what we need more than anything else is godliness. 3 John 2 says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Everybody wants to prosper and be in health, but we forget our soul. turn on the TV and everybody's believing God for a house and a car. I'm believing God for holiness and courage. I'm taking him at his word that he can keep me from falling and present me faultless before his presence with exceeding glory and joy. I'm taking him at his word that he would deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. I'm taking him at his word that he can cleanse me from secret faults and keep me back from presumptuous sins, that they may not have dominion over me. Then I shall be upright, and I shall be innocent of great transgression. There's power in the word of God. And that's what I want in my mouth. I want God's word in my mouth, because God's word is the only word that has power. It's the only word that has life. God's words are the ones that don't come void or empty. I don't want to walk around quoting Kanye or Beyonce talking about broken hearts, but they have no power to mend them. I want to quote the one who mends the broken heart and binds up their wounds. Don't want to walk around quoting the Temptations, talking about I ain't too proud to beg. I want to quote the sustainer of my life who says that I don't have to. I don't want to quote the Negro spiritual, sometimes I feel like a motherless child. I want to quote the everlasting Father who said that though my mother and father forsake me, he would take me up. Don't want to quote Flip Wilson talking about the devil made me do it. I want to quote Jesus who said, but God soon will crush Satan under my feet shortly. There is power in his word. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Let me more of thy beauty see. Wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty. Teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words. Wonderful words. Creative words, life-giving words, amazing words, excellent words, inspired words, miraculous words, wonderful words of life. Somebody bless God for his word. Bless the Lord in this place. As the musicians begin to play, I'm closing now. A story is told of a man. That's the classic appeal line. He was homeless and he had little to eat. He ate out of garbage cans and had to sleep in a park. Perhaps it was a cold and blistering night, much like tonight. Whatever the case, they found him dead, lying in the snow on a park bench. They were doing the autopsy, trying to ID the man, and they found a money belt around his waist. For the most part, it was empty, save a couple of papers. But one of those papers was very important. It was a will that entitled him to several million dollars. He never got it. He died in poverty because he could not read. It indeed would be a great tragedy if, in light of the awesome and generous inheritance that Jesus the Christ have left us, if we continue to live, oh God, even die in poverty. There is so much power, so much righteousness, so much godliness to be had. All things pertaining to life and godliness have been generously provided for us, but we have to be able to read. We've got to read the book. brothers and sisters, I commend to you this book. Let it take root in your life. The centurion just wanted Christ to speak a word. And today he has. All we have to do is get into it. Now, please forgive me. Forgive me for even thinking that pastors would need to read the Bible just a little more. My call to action is simple this evening. However much you study the Bible, I just want you to add 5 more minutes to it. So for those of you who read the Bible 4 hours a day, my humble request is that you would read it 4 hours and 5 minutes. For those of you who just do an hour and 5 minutes, for those of you who read 2 chapters a day, 2 chapters and 5 minutes, and for those of you who haven't gotten around to doing it as of yet, I want you to start with 5 minutes. Wherever you are, I just want you to add just a little more. That's my call to action this day. I'm not talking about a devotional. I'm not talking about Sabbath school lessons. I'm not even talking about the writings of your favorite author. I just want you to get in the Word for 5 minutes a day, more than you are doing now. And if that is your commitment, then I invite you to stand to your feet as we pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we pray that you would look down on this building and be pleased. Heavenly Father, I hope that when you look down upon us, you would see a people who are thirsty after your word. Oh God, we know that there is power in your word, deliverance in your word. We confess that we have not valued it as much as we could. But Lord, we repent and turn from that, and we promise that we're going to do more than we have been doing. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for beginning this good work in us. Now, God, I ask that you would send your angels and Holy Spirit that excels in strength to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. And when all is said and done, may we see all in this assembly, in that great assembly around the throne of heaven. Oh God, may none be lost. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind. It's closer now than it's ever been. I can hear the trumpet. As Gabriel sounds the call at the midnight's cry, we'll be going home. I look around me, I see prophecy fulfilling every day. Signs of the times, they're appearing. I can almost hear my daddy as he says, son, go and get my children, all of my children, at the midnight cry. The bride of Christ shall prophecy fulfilling every day. Yes, it is. The signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can hear. At that midnight cry, the bride of Christ shall rise. Oh, when Christ steps out on a cloud to call his children. Oh, yes, he will. The day. Just to meet him in the air.
Great God Almighty, something ought to be said. Well, you're blessed tonight. That the Lord pour out His Spirit on you. We ought to put our hands up and say, Lord, bless the preacher. Lord, bless the preacher. My God, what a word. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's not over yet. I promise you, before you can get to your car, God has another blessing for you. I'm going to ask those in the media booth that they will turn on our DVD. I want you to share something with me. I promised a little girl that I would tell you her story. Her name is Abigail. She's just a little girl, but she's the head of her house now because she lost both her mother and her father. She didn't have anybody else in the world now. There's no government support. There's no welfare. But by the grace of God, there was a pastor and his wife who were so passionate about wanting to plant a church that they asked God to make a way when there was no way. All right. Please, 13 minutes, Ingelo.
Terrain is rough, dusty, unpaved roads, much like what Jesus had to walk in Palestine.
And they walk for miles in order to visit their patients. I asked one, why do you do it? And her response was, I do it because I feel that God has placed it within me to do it.
To watch these individuals as they were taking care of these people that she talked about, and her eyes would sparkle and she kept saying, I have to be here, you know, I'm their only hope.
Oh, my brother, how are you?
Pleasure.
Welcome to South Africa.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pastor Paul Mawela and his wife, Martha, came here retired, and they had a burden to do ministry, wanted to start a church. It didn't work out. The locals felt that they had enough churches.
How are you?
Fine.
Good.
And when I couldn't start a church, the Lord impressed upon me that we could do something in which we could work together.
Alvin is my name.
Oh, okay. He got together with some of the local pastors and said, look, we have a common enemy. And so, putting aside denominational lines, they've come together to fight the AIDS epidemic here in South Africa.
The project is called Nhlengelo, a Tsonga name for standing together against an enemy. To fight against enemy HIV and AIDS.
When we arrived on Tuesday morning, we met 25 or 30 women, and we found out that they were called caregivers, and that they visited homes of some HIV patients, tuberculosis patients.
What would happen to these individuals?
We sat down with them, we met with them, interviewed them, and they share with us what they did every day. And Martin said, I have 105 people I visit every day. I said, week? She said, no, every day I visit 105 people. I said, what about you? The lady said, well, I have 124 that I visit every day. How do you go? By feet, not automobile. And I said, wow, I know you're kidding. She said, no, we do it every day.
We asked the caregivers, how did you find these people? How did you find the people? And they said, door to door. They walked door to door, knocking on the doors and looking for individuals that needed help.
And they actually entered into the lives of people by
going there and seeking out the needs of those who have been afflicted by AIDS. They are the ones who lay hands on in a very real way. They touch lives, they mingle with the people, they get to know them and they minister to their needs.
At Nhlengelo, we have 40 caregivers. Those are the people who visit the homes, make sure they know how many sick people and from what are they suffering from. Sometimes they have to clean the house where the patient is sleeping, do some washing for the patient, change the bedding, bathe the patients.
Offer them care, compassion, and to just to see to their well-being. It's really a mission of mercy, a mission of love that they demonstrate on a daily basis.
We have the privilege of visiting homes. I don't know how the other members of my group felt, but I felt a measure of apprehension and concern going into the home. I didn't know what I was going to encounter there.
Where we went, the lady couldn't walk and her joints were stiff, and the caregiver just massaged her ankles and her feet and her arms wherever there was pain.
Cleaning their homes, cleaning their wounds, their sores, administering their medications. They see these individuals not as pure victims. They see them as individuals created in the image of God, and they treat them as such.
Their commitment to their patients that they see was just unbelievable. They knew everything about those families, the names of their children, the ages of their children. They could tell you everything about those individuals.
The caregivers are not paid. They are given a stipend of 500 rand a month only. That is not enough for the type of work they're doing.
When I learned that they'd volunteer their services, that they were giving completely of themselves, walking 2-3 hours in one direction and then 2-3 hours back home just to go visit individuals who are sick. When I watch the way they give of themselves and touch the people, hug the people, they were not concerned about themselves. That's ministry.
On Tuesday afternoon, we got to meet with the children. They'd just come from school, and we got the opportunity to mingle with them and to get to know some of their stories and get to understand where they're coming from.
And what's your name?
The children that come to Ngelo are orphans.
It's a picture of AIDS.
Their parents have passed away as a result of AIDS.
We call them child-headed homes. These children live by themselves. The eldest one needs to take the initiative.
They have to act as mother and father, 9 and 10 years old, and head of the household, that you have to provide for your little brothers and sisters.
What grade are you?
Five.
I sat down with about 5 little boys and talked to them. The common language that we had was laughter. And they made me laugh.
It was a wonderful experience to be able to serve all the children in Ngela.
And to see these children standing on line, waiting so patiently, and they would all say thank you. You know, they were just so grateful. So, you know, it's, I don't know, it's just something else.
I was surprised to find how happy the kids were, in spite of their situation. They were entertaining us a whole lot, and I was taken up with what they were doing, and I thought the kids needed to have some enjoyment themselves. That was a special moment for me.
And I really thought my ministry should have been to them, but their ministry was to me, and I appreciate it. The experience of seeing the joy in their eyes of just being cared for by our presence.
He was the truth. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
We had this incredible gathering together in this tent out in the very rural setting, and people packing in from all sides. And in the midst of all this, the whole purpose was to dedicate this church.
One of the things that I was impressed with is the interpreter on that day. He is a pastor of a non-Adventist church, and Papa Muella had developed such a bond with these pastors that he invited them to come to the worship experience.
Following the service, we left the tent and went to this new building there that the people in the community were just absolutely thrilled with.
We would love to say thank you so very much to Pastor and Mrs. Mawila for this church building.
To see the community involved in the dedication yesterday and to listen to how the chief of the village asked him, okay, you've done all this work at Angela, feeding orphans and literacy and taking care of patients. When are you going to build your church?
This was an area where our church had not previously been welcomed, but here were community leaders not only welcoming us to the area, but they were even admonishing the community individuals to come to church, come to Sabbath school, bring your children, be on time, because this church is the church for the community. After that service, seven souls were baptized.
The way that our pioneers used to do it, down by the riverside.
It was a moving experience, wonderful to behold, and the joy of salvation on the faces of those who took their stand for Christ.
I think that Ngelo is important to the Hope for Humanity initiative because it epitomizes the very best and the most sincere of our hopes and our desire to replicate the ministry and the love of Jesus Christ. I believe that Pastor and Mrs. Mawela are ambassadors of heaven. They're God's ambassadors. They're not about anything or anybody but the people that they serve.
Now that I've been here, I've come to see that there's a lot of work to be done, that people are here sacrificing, giving all that they have to give comfort and relief to people.
The work that they're doing would be what Jesus would do if he was here walking the earth right now. He would go from house to house comforting, praying, doing whatever he could.
I saw Jesus in the faces of the children. I saw him in the hands of the caregivers. I saw him in the patients as they looked back at their caregivers. I saw him more clearly than I think I've ever seen him before.
In this partnership, there's nothing that we can give back to the church except our hearts, except our prayers, except our thanks. That's all we can give. But I am looking forward to a time when the Lord will come and there will be a great harvest of souls from this part of the world because of the partnership that we have had with Hope for Humanity.
Stop complaining about what we don't have. We don't know poverty. We don't know poverty. I don't know how many of you have children, but if you can imagine what it would be like If both you and your spouse were gone, there was no bank account, there was no government, there was no support, what would they do? The caregivers have nothing to give but themselves. If we would just do something, I can't solve all the problems in all the world, but I can do something. I can make a difference. I can help some child. There are a number of your administrators who were there. I will never forget it. I can't forget it. There's not a day that I can allow myself to forget. These individuals have been there. They are more than willing to share the story because simply of the love of Pastor and Mrs. Mawela. We now have a thriving church in that community, and the village chief wants them to build another. Amen. We learned so much from them about leadership and service, about ministry, that we could take up the rest of this convention talking to you about it. But this is the new in-gathering program, and Dr. DePinto is the one who put it together. I stood on the year-end floor several years ago and begged them not to kill the in-gathering program. I begged the then president, don't do this, because there were still people in need. And although we had reached a sophistication where we thought it was out of date, there was one thing that stayed in my mind, and that was the word of Jesus Christ. He said, the poor will be with you always. Always. And then he followed that by saying, inasmuch as you have done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. If you are not supporting the in-gathering program, then please tell me why so I can explain it to the children that I met in Dwarsloop. That you didn't have the time or that you thought that it was begging. But it's not only the program in Dwarsloop, it's the program in Guatemala, it's the program in Nicaragua, it's in many other places of the world. The local conference has the opportunity to choose the ministry that they want to adopt so that you have a hands-on relationship. The literature has been passed out. The information is there. I leave it with you. Let's determine to stand together against a common enemy.
Thank you, Elder Alvin Kibble. The video certainly speaks for itself, and we are committed to rally around this project. And we trust that as Elder Kibble moves in and out among us during this council and beyond this council, you will commit yourself to whatever he presents as being practical and the kind of help that will actually reach in Galo. And we thank you. We thank you. The hour is late. Let us stand for prayer. Pastor Trusty King, please pray for us.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your visitation this evening. Lord, we ask that your presence would continue to go with us as we leave this place. We love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
God be with you until we meet again, namely 8:15 tomorrow morning in the chapel.